Recorded Books presents Village in the Sky by Jack McDevitt. Narrated by Jennifer Van Dyck. Dates not marked CE are from the Rimwe calendar. Action is set in the 12th millennium. Prologue, 1436, Rimwe calendar. From Edmund Barringer, Lifeboat, Common Era, 87-88. There is no quality, no essence, no effect so distressing as the silence that pours out of the stars. I never thought the day would come when I'd settle in to write an Alex Benedict memoir in which Alex and I are the bad guys. It started when Quaid McCann took the Columbia on a routine mission for the Visitation Project. McCann was on the board of directors of the project, which was about to close down. Again. Officially, they were compiling a list of habitable worlds for eventual colonization. But as everyone connected with the organization knew, they were really looking for someone to talk with. The first interstellar vehicles had been activated in ancient times. 9,000 years ago. They'd gone out into local planetary systems and gradually moved on to distant stars, where they found nothing other than a few archaeological sites, only a few of which had shown any sign of an advanced civilization. But they were all long gone. The evidence indicated that while life was not rare, intelligence was almost non-existent. And when advanced civilizations developed, they inevitably destroyed themselves. Humans had come close to doing that, but we'd been lucky. The right people had shown up at the right times. Human colonies were established around neighboring stars, while we came gradually to accept the unrelenting silence that seemed as much a part of the natural order as starlight. Eventually, we discovered the Ashier, the only intelligent beings with whom we'd been able to sit down. But they did not have a speech capability. The Ashier communicated by telepathy. They were the mutes. And they read our minds as well as their own, so we were never comfortable in their presence. Missions like this one seemed pointless. The scientific world supported the efforts of people like McCann, although they showed no confidence that he would ever find anyone. His wife, Edna, had given up hope that he would ever recognize it as a colossal waste of time. But she understood why he persisted, though not enough to accompany him after his first effort. The Columbia had been in deep space almost 7 months, had visited 19 planetary systems along the far edge of the Orion Nebula, examined 26 terrestrial worlds, and found absolutely nothing of interest. A few had jungles and whales, trees and grasslands, herds of creatures thundering across broad landscapes. Most were simply arid and windswept, and, as far as they could see, lifeless. There might have been microorganisms down there somewhere, but they wouldn't be of any consequence for millions of years. The systems certainly hadn't seen anything that might have an inclination to say hello. McCann's pilot, Robbie Joe Renfro, had been a friend of mine since our early school days. She understood that even McCann had given up finally and was ready to quit. Just as well. They were running low on supplies. He surprised her as they approached the final system. "I'm ready," he said. "To find a more rational way to waste my life." He'd spent years on these missions, and he'd noticed that few of those who accompanied him ever returned for an additional flight. But she suspected that eventually he'd be out there again. He would stay with the project as long as he was breathing. The consolation was that the general emptiness would make success, if it could ever be achieved, even more compelling. He would become part of history. Though it wasn't the acquisition of fame that drove him. It was the Milky Way. It was just too big to be empty. There had to be others out there, and he was determined to find them. Their last visit was to be in the system of a K-class dwarf star. They'd named it Corella, after one of McCann's uncles. They'd detected 5 planets in the system. There might have been more, but if so, they were too far out to be of interest. For that matter, only 3 of the 5 were orbiting in the Goldilocks zone. One of those was a gas giant, and another was a barren world of rocks, methane, and ice. But the third one was a terrestrial. It had oceans and continents, always a good sign, and there was a green landscape. White clouds drifted through the sky. McCann was on the bridge with Robbie Joe, leaning forward as if it would provide a better look. "Let's hope," he'd said. Robbie Joe had grown to hate long, lonely voyages, but if they ever found anything, she wanted to be there. So she'd rolled the dice on this one. But she'd also given up and decided never again. So this was her last chance. But maybe there would be a payoff. That possibility occurred to her, not because the world was green. That was not uncommon. But there was something about the appearance and the color that suggested they'd struck gold. Or maybe it was just McCann's desperation and a sense that something would happen to prevent his going home empty again. They came in on the sunlit side. They were still too far out to see whether anything was moving on the ground or fluttering through the sky. McCann wasn't talking about radio signals, but that was what he was really looking for. Unfortunately, though, the receiver remained silent. He would have preferred to be on the night side, watching somebody down there turn on the lights. They saw no sign of any kind of structure. As usual, it looked as if there was nobody there. We understand why intelligent species are not likely to appear even on worlds where conditions are perfect. The complexity of the molecular combinations required simply to produce life on a world with the right chemicals and conditions reduced the chances substantially. Add the nearly impossible requirements needed to generate brain evolution, and the odds become extreme.
"I wonder," McCann had asked a couple of times, "why we care so much. If the universe is really empty, except for us and the mutes, it's a much safer place."
He was right, of course. With earthquakes and tidal waves, crashing asteroids, black holes, and exploding stars, the Milky Way is already sufficiently hostile to its life forms, its children, as the poet Tess Harmon had once described us. When finally we met the mutes, we ended up in a war with them. Maybe that was the reason for the emptiness. There really might be a god behind everything, one who understood that intelligent beings are stupid, inevitably inclined to fight. So he keeps the numbers down. It makes sense. It was just after midnight on board the Columbia when McCann went back to get some sleep. He left Robbie Joe alone on the bridge. The sky was filled with stars. After McCann left, she went back into the passenger cabin. Vince Reddington and Jason Albright were the only ones there. Vince was the backup pilot. Jason was tall and blonde, a physicist who'd won a couple of major awards, though he looked too young to have managed anything like that. They were listening to a performance from their library by a late-night comedian. It was strictly audio. The view from the ship's telescope was on the monitor. She sat down where she could watch the screen. After a while, she fell asleep. She was out for about an hour before the guys woke her. They could see movement on the ground. When they got closer, they were able to make out a few animals running across a prairie under a full moon. Robbie Joe moved the scope and saw mountains, rivers, and a forest. Birds or something flew through the night sky. A herd of 4-legged creatures were making their way casually across a sloping plain near the base of one of the mountains, while a solitary beast that might have been a leopard watched. A pair of gator-sized lizards climbed out of a river, and something with multiple legs dashed across open space before disappearing into a cluster of trees. And then
she saw a light. Of course, we all know what happened next. The village. It was the discovery of a lifetime. Vince and Jason erupted with enthusiasm. The door to McCann's cabin opened, and he joined them, yelling about not believing it, and at last. They were still a substantial distance out, but the telescope locked on it. McCann was laughing and pounding Vince's back. He hugged Jason and Robbie Joe, who later described it as the wildest moment in her life. It was a lot more than a village. The architecture was glossy in the moonlight, elegant, and somehow amicable, a place that welcomed visitors. There were log cabins and chateaus and villas. The light they'd seen came from a couple of lampposts and one of the houses. Otherwise, everything was dark. The village was set along the edge of a lake. It looked like the sort of place that McCann's wealthier colleagues frequently built halfway up a mountain or along a shoreline, a place to which people could retreat and leave their mundane lives behind. They saw movement. Someone was walking on one of the roadways. They weren't close enough to be able to make out anything other than that it was a biped and it wore clothes. It entered one of the houses, not the one with the light. The center of the village was occupied by a pair of large connected structures, possibly a school or a church or a town hall. Who knew? We've all seen the pictures. The buildings had shafts, balconies, cupolas, arches, and domes. Most of the architecture was curved. It consisted of polished structures with balustrades and round arched windows, cornices, circular entrance steps, parapets, and spires. They had pitched rooftops supported by rounded columns. The houses ranged from 1 to 3 stories. Everything gave the illusion of a rising symmetry, as if the design of the individual structures was somehow unified, more than simply a set of buildings separated by dirt roads. They had almost an hour to watch, during which other bipeds wandered through the streets, before the planetary rotation took them out of view. When they were gone, McCann and his team went through another period of backslapping and exchanging congratulations. At last. It was hard to believe. For Robbie Joe, though, and maybe for all of them, the sheer joy contained an element of disappointment. They weren't permitted to make contact. They were required by the Spalding mandate to do what they could to avoid allowing the aliens even to notice their presence. And they had complied accordingly. They knew where the village was, so they had no trouble finding it. It was back in daylight again when they passed overhead, and they got their first good look at the aliens. They had bright green skin, with a silver tint, faces with standard features. They couldn't determine how big they were. Ears and nose were elongated, and their eyes appeared to be set wide apart. They wore trousers and shorts and colorful shirts. There was no sign of hair. They appeared to move with grace. They were everywhere in the town. No vehicles, though.
"It makes no sense," McCann said. "Where's everybody else?"
They left the area and expanded their search across sections they hadn't seen previously. Nothing changed. Forests and plains and mountains and occasional deserts were all they could find. The village seemed to be the only occupied location on the planet. They came back when night had fallen. Lights were on in most of the houses. The lampposts were also lit up. Still, nothing on the radio.
"They probably wouldn't have any use for a radio," said Vince. "Nobody's more than a few blocks away."
"So what do we do?" asked Jason.
"I guess," said McCann, "we go home and report it."
Vince didn't like the idea.
"Why don't we take the lander down and say hello? They don't look dangerous."
McCann closed his eyes and shook his head.
"Break the mandate, and we'll all be in trouble."
"Mac," said Jason,
We can't just walk away from this.
McCann's eyes hardened.
Yes, we can. Suppose you go down and we scare them and they attack us. What do? They have weapons. You really want to go home and explain that you killed a couple of these people?
Mac. Vince obviously thought they had no choice. We can't just ignore what we've found.
Look, we can go down in the lander, stay well away from the town, and keep out of sight. It shouldn't be all that hard. No.
McCann wasn't going to budge. The lights in one of the houses went out. They were outside lights on the porch, and a post light. They all shut off together, so that removed any possibility that the aliens were using candles or gas lights. In the end, as we all know, the Columbia just packed up and came home. Chapter 1. From Walford Candle's Ride by Night, 1196. I rode into the dark, expecting to see my love in the moonlight. But there was no moon, and not even a star. Nevertheless, she was there. I had but to find her. It started on an early spring afternoon, while I was playing volleyball. We were on an outdoor court at the Terra Center when somebody began shooting off fireworks. Sirens sounded, and I heard a commotion inside the center. We stopped for a couple of minutes and looked at each other, and when nothing more happened, we resumed playing. I don't recall any more of the volleyball details, whether my side was winning or losing. I don't even remember whether it was a league game or just a couple of teams that we'd put together. All that disappeared in the turmoil that erupted that evening. We showered, and as soon as I got access to my link, I checked it to find out what was going on. We were informed that the research vehicle Columbia had discovered intelligent life. The only details were that they'd found a small town and that they'd seen the inhabitants, who were green-skinned. The town was a long way out. It was an exciting time. Real aliens. We were informed that plans already existed for a follow-up mission. I was excited, not only because of the discovery, but for another reason. Robbie Joe Renfro had been piloting the mission. I hadn't known anything about it, except that she'd been gone a long time. There wasn't much detail available about the flight. They'd named the place Corella 4, but released minimal other information. There was no data regarding the world's location. I tried doing a search for it, but I didn't know at the time that the name had been selected by McCann. Robbie Joe and I had been out of contact for a few years, but I hadn't been surprised when I'd seen her name listed as the mission's pilot. I remembered standing with her under a starlit sky when we were both about 12 years old. Robbie Joe asked me if I thought it ever ended, the sky. If it did, what was at the edge? Was there a wall of some sort? Her mom had told her no, that the universe wasn't like that, that space was skewered. That was the term she'd used. So it didn't come to a stop, it just became circular in a way that seemed impossible to understand. But if you went in one direction far enough, eventually you came in from the other side. And she recalled her refusal to believe it when her mom said it was pretty much all empty out there. Nobody home. Robbie Joe made it her lifetime goal to find someone, anyone, which was more or less how she eventually got caught up with the Columbia. And she'd made it happen. Good for her. Actually, we'd never been especially close, but we'd met as girl troopers during our grade school years. We both played on our high school's basketball team, and for a time we'd hung out together. She'd always had a fascination with stars and galaxies. She'd told me once that she planned to become an astronomer. If anyone I'd known was going to be on that flight, she would be the one. The teachers loved her. She won the highly acclaimed Orion Award 2 years after high school for her article, "Why Is It So Empty?" which appeared in the Antiquarian. It was a prize I'd have killed for, but I simply didn't have the writing skills. Or maybe I just didn't know how to dig into the cultural issues in a way that would hold a reader's interest. I knew she wouldn't be home for a while, but I couldn't resist sending her a congratulatory note. "Wish I'd been with you," I wrote, and I added a reference to our basketball days in case she'd forgotten who I was. The street was filled with people laughing and embracing and staring at their links. "Greetings, aliens," said the headline in the Andaquar Sentinel. There wasn't much detail on what they looked like, other than their green skin, but the hunt that had been going on for thousands of years, producing nothing other than ruins and the mutes, was finally at an end. United Media had an anchor and two guests discussing the story and wondering whether we'd wind up in a war again. Several of us crossed Wayland Street to the Akron Bar, where we could join the celebration while the reports came in. The pictures of the town, which had arrived as part of a hypercom transmission, revealed a village that might have been located outside Casper County. Modest houses, dirt roads, a long building that looked like a school. Despite the town's simplicity, there was a harmony and polish that underscored its unity. Everything seemed to be connected. It was somehow a single configuration, rather than a group of individual houses and small buildings. The mission also reported they'd found nothing else on the planet. Of course, the assumption was that they'd probably sent the report immediately after sighting the village, but as time passed, we learned that they'd searched the planet and found no additional dwellings. How could that happen? It became the question of the hour. The operation had been sponsored by the Visitation Project. The Columbia reported that in accordance with the Spalding mandate, they'd not made contact, would keep a respectful distance, and that there was no indication that their presence had been detected. They suggested a backup unit be dispatched to establish communications. It was certainly not the kind of first contact we'd been hoping for, a lonely, desolate village. But it was better than nothing. The Department of Planetary Survey and Astronomical Research, DIPSAR, maintained an office in Andaquar. One of their primary responsibilities was to maintain a training program designed to create specialists who could establish friendly communications should we discover aliens somewhere, or if they showed up over the Melanie River. That was the Xenicon program. It was a tricky business, since nobody had had any experience with communicating with aliens. I don't think anyone had ever taken the program very seriously, for that matter. But the lack of preparation led us into the war with the mutes. If we came into contact with another alien species, we certainly didn't want to do a repeat. It was inevitable, I guess, that the day would come. So when it finally did, we were prepared to do some bridge building. Connect our AIs with theirs, if they had any. Speak softly. Smile. Don't do anything that could be interpreted as threatening. And don't tell anyone where the Confederacy worlds are located until we have a good handle on their intentions. And hope we had it right. There was also a branch of DIPSAR people who maintained that we should just stay away and keep our hands off. A few days after the initial Columbia transmission had arrived, we got word that the mission had started home. There was no indication that anything had changed. Since it took 2 weeks for a hypercom signal to arrive from Corella, the Columbia by then was halfway back. DIPSAR called in its Xenicon volunteers. I was among them. Don't ask how I got involved. Even now, I'm not sure. They had parties and the conferences were interesting, so I signed on. The director was Henry Cassell, who'd spent a lot of time with the mutes. He started that first day by telling us DIPSAR was looking for volunteers to travel to Corella 4 and establish communications with the aliens. "They have electricity," he said. "The houses look good, but beyond that, they don't seem to have much technology. And one aspect that is especially curious is that they seem to be alone on the planet." Henry was a middle-aged guy with a kindly appearance and amicable green eyes, though they had an intense appearance that night. He looked around at us and asked
who was willing to go. He was going. They needed 5 other people, plus a pilot. They had no way of knowing how long they would stay in the area, but Henry doubted it would be more than a few days. But don't sign on if you can't manage a flight of at least 3 months. There were only a dozen of us physically in the building, but there were probably 20 more electronically present. Most were positioned on other Confederate worlds, and even though they were locked in through hypercom, there was a delay of up to several minutes while messages went back and forth. Meanwhile, 3 of those present raised their hands. Jim Pollard, who'd always maintained he would love to be a part of a contact mission, hesitated and then put his hand in the air. I was still thinking about it when the electronic results started to show up. There weren't as many as I would have expected. Aliens living in log cabins and stone houses just didn't cut it. Since everyone knew this was coming, I talked it over with Alex before signing on. He gave me an okay, with a comment that it didn't sound very exciting. A woman on one of the electronic connections asked why we were taking only 7. "The Harbinger," she said, "can carry twice that many." Henry delivered a tolerant smile. "Not for this distance," he said. "Aside from that, we should all be aware there's a degree of risk about this type of mission. We don't need twice as many people as we can carry. And for the record, we expect to take 1 of the people from the Columbia." The major question that dominated the meeting was whether we were actually going to establish contact. "We haven't decided yet," he said. "That's a difficult question. We'll go and take a look, and I suspect we'll decide depending on what we learn about them. And don't ask me how we're going to learn anything without talking to them. We haven't figured it out yet." 3 months in an interstellar. I had a decent social life at that time, which I did not want to leave for an extended period. But it was hard to just stand there and do nothing. My chances would have been pretty good to get picked had I known where Corella 4 was. That was why they wanted someone from the Columbia. And preferably, that would be either Reddington or Robbie Joe. In the end, I wasn't really that excited about a few 100 aliens in a town in the middle of nowhere, so I stayed out of it. The final count gave Henry 22 volunteers. When it was over, he thanked us for our interest. "I'm sorry we won't be able to accommodate everybody. We just can't pack enough supplies into the Harbinger." He shrugged, pretending not to be surprised at the level of enthusiasm. "We should probably have gotten hold of the Alhambra for this operation." That got some laughs. We could have gotten half of Andaquar on board the Alhambra. He told us that it would take a while, a few weeks, to put everything together, and that he'd get back to the volunteers as quickly as he could. I spent the weekend mountain climbing with Chad Barker and a few others. Chad was a boyfriend at the time. We took our first break at Wiley's Bar and Grill, just south of Morley Canyon. We kept our links turned off, but the Columbia story was all over the news at Wiley's. I stayed with it for the next 2 days. The hosts on every major show had people in to discuss what was happening, whether we should be concerned about who was out there, and what effects the connection with a totally alien culture might have on our own lives. Would the aliens be hostile? Would they have a religion? Could we be sure the ones in the cabins weren't there to fool us into underestimating their tech capabilities? Transmissions from Quaid McCann on the incoming Columbia were arriving almost daily. And Greg Lindsay, the host of Night Talk, brought McCann's wife Edna in for an interview. Did she wish now that she'd gone along on the mission? "No," she said. "If anybody was going to do it, I'd have put my money on Quaid. He's been trying to find someone out there his entire life. Most of the people we know always thought he was wasting his time, but he just couldn't be talked down from it." "Edna, are there any plans to bring some of the aliens back here?"
"You mean to Andaquar?"
"No, they wouldn't be allowed to do anything like that. Greg, you know there are laws against it."
"Sure, but if we run into something that seems friendly, who knows how we might respond?"
"I'd be shocked if my husband ignored the law." 20 minutes later, Lindsay was talking to Clint Elliott, a historian whose area of special interest was the war with the mutes.
Could it happen again, Clint? Could the aliens seize the ship's crew and learn where we are located?
Well, Greg, that's kind of a foolish question, since they're already on the way home and there's been no report of trouble. Maybe they're all at gunpoint.
For a moment, I thought Elliot was going to throw something at him. When I got home, I switched on the Golden Network. The host, Morris Cassidy, brought in Jennifer Hancock to join the upcoming Harbinger mission. Jennifer had been on a previous flight, and she had a master's in astrobio. She was tall, with dark eyes and a voice that made it clear she was completely reliable and in charge.
Yes, she said. Of course, we're sending a research team out. We're all trained for this kind of thing. We should be leaving within a week or two.
Will you guys say hello, the research team?
Probably not, unless the aliens find a way to say something. Her smile suggested she was toying with Cassidy. We'll be concentrating on finding out what we can without making a connection. That's more for their benefit than ours. It looks like a pretty primitive culture. Cassidy started to say something, but she kept going.
I understand they have electricity, but they're living in a village, and they seem to be the only people on the planet.
She shook her head. I don't see any way they could constitute a threat.
Jennifer, where is this place?
Corella 4.
It's a long way out, in the Orion Nebula. Other than that, we won't be making details public.
You don't want people going out and taking a look?
It could be dangerous, Morris. Not so much to us as to them. We don't want to scare a primitive culture. We don't know anything about who's there, so we'll just keep our distance.
A warning had been issued that same evening that anyone attempting without permission from Dipsar to visit the place would be in violation of the law and subject to substantial penalties. The Glenville Archaeological Society had its monthly conference two nights later. Gabe was scheduled as the guest speaker. I was pretty sure Henry Cassell would be there too. The last few days had been a major struggle. Henry had offered to include me with the crew of the Harbinger. I suspect my connection with Alex had something to do with that. I just couldn't make up my mind about it. The flight would be historical, and a golden chance to establish my reputation as someone other than Alex's assistant. Even without that, being present when we said hello to the aliens was a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. And I should mention that I wasn't among those who thought the follow-up mission was just going out there to look around and not make contact. But I didn't see anything particularly interesting about the village on the prairie. They were going to spend 2 months inside the Harbinger, to say hello to the villagers, and presumably find out they just didn't reproduce much, or whatever. My life with Chad had taken off, and I didn't want to leave him, especially since I'd seen how many of his bookstore customers were attractive young women. Gabe planned to talk about some of the artifacts found during his recent trip to Marinda, a city at Point Edward that had been abandoned centuries ago for reasons still in dispute. They traditionally do the event at the Acadia Hotel, adjacent to Ogilby Park. They'd turned on the force field billboard that floated just a few meters above the top of the hotel, divulging the title and time of the event. Gabe's name was prominently on display, as well as his topic. Chad was interested in going, so I offered to take Gabe as well. He passed because he was scheduled to sign books earlier at a Mount Barrett store, but he supplied me with two tickets. Chad picked me up and we rode his skimmer out to the hotel. We descended into the parking area, went inside the Acadia, said hello to a couple of people we knew, and sat down at a reserved table. The place was almost filled. I spotted Henry, who, unfortunately, was seated on the far side of the room. I'd have loved to find him at my table, but he was a VIP, so there was no way that was going to happen. The dinner was good. A choice between salmon and pork roast.
I couldn't help being happy that I wasn't there to talk to that packed house. Nothing scares me quite as much as public speaking. When I'd finished the meal, I decided to order a dessert. Strawberry shortcake sounded right. It was hard to believe that in the ancient world we'd killed farm animals to provide food. That, of course, was before we developed nutrient generators, which use cloned cells to provide all the meat, fish, vegetables, and desserts we need. I was just finishing when the Society's event secretary took her place at the lectern and spoke for several minutes about current projects. The Society had selected a local high school student for its annual Jeremy Cranston Award. The winner was announced and came up to receive a plaque. She was also given passage to Delaconda, where she could do some sightseeing, as well as participate in an archaeological dig at a site near the ancient Cormite city of Barakaya. After the applause settled down, the event secretary introduced the guest speaker, Professor Gabriel Benedict. Gabe came onto the stage, bringing a drink with him. "Good evening, ladies and gentlemen." He looked out over us with a broad smile that suggested he would have made an excellent talk show host. "We're gathered together this evening in historic times. I know you were informed that my subject would be the recent recovery of artifacts found at Morinda, and that I would present a theory as to what really happened there. But I know, at a time like this, nobody really cares about a deserted city on Point Edward. This has been a fairly big week." He smiled as Fairly drew a ton of laughter. "After all these years, we have apparently actually encountered some aliens. I can't help thinking that when we come back for the meeting next month, the Harbinger will probably already be on its way to Corella, and there'll be at least one more meeting before we hear anything back from them." He stopped, and momentary confusion wrinkled his features. "Bear with me. My physics isn't exactly up to date. I'm not sure how long those hypercom transmissions take to get back to us. But anyhow, we might by then have some serious news about them, about the aliens. Maybe when we get into the middle of the summer, we'll have one of the aliens as our guest speaker. That's one we wouldn't want to miss." He switched back to Morinda and spent several minutes on why artifacts matter. "They provide the only real way we can touch the past, and that's why we go to such measures to preserve them. Does the past really matter? Think what it feels like when you go back to the home you grew up in and everything's changed. The AI's been replaced by a stranger, the front porch is now enclosed, the house next door where the McClellans lived has become a tech shop." He paused, and his audience applauded until he held up a hand. "It's how we know who we are." There wasn't much point that night in talking about anything other than aliens, however, so Gabe told stories from a couple of the expeditions he'd shared with mutes. "Any archaeologist will tell you that once the digging starts, they spend a lot of time hoping for what will be found. Maybe the lost body of the young Galatian hero Ali Moras, or Kim Marco's notebook." Moras had, of course, sacrificed himself to draw the savage Wakians away from the group fleeing visitors at Tyro Falls. "It's hard to believe," he said, "that humans in an advanced society can still murder each other, can kill strangers, but isolate them for a while, put them in an area seldom visited by others, and it happens. Marco's notebook was the reason we were there. It had disappeared shortly before his death. Marco is generally credited as one of the best playwrights ever. I'll confess, I'm not a fan. His plays are a bit too complicated for me. But however that may be, the notebook, if we could find it, would be priceless." But Gabe could not help returning to the Columbia. "The one thought I suspect we're all sharing this evening is how much any of us would give to have been with the people on that ship." He finished his remarks a few minutes later after getting more applause and laughs. Then he invited questions. The first one was usually the same at all his speaking events.
How did he get interested in archaeology?
It's hard to see how you can earn any money digging up ancient cities. Would you recommend it as a career?
Of course, the subject of the day surfaced quickly.
What about the aliens? Would you be interested in collecting artifacts from them? Would they be more valuable than stuff from Mirinda?
Gabe said he thought alien artifacts sounded like a good idea. That got more laughs. A few minutes later, he wished us all a good evening. Henry was slow to leave his table at the end. He waited for Gabe to come down off the stage, and then he got up and headed in his direction. Henry and Gabe got together and talked for a few minutes. Then Gabe said a few parting words to the event secretary and turned back to Henry. They knew each other pretty well. Chad and I stayed at our table. They eventually began to walk toward the doors. I was hoping to get Henry alone, but it didn't look as if it was going to happen. There were still a few people lingering at their tables, but most were now headed for the exit. Chad and I got up and joined them as bots began gathering dishes. We walked leisurely, off to one side in plain view so Henry could see me. I'd told Chad that I'd been invited to join the Harbinger flight. When he asked about my intentions, I told him I hadn't made up my mind yet. We preceded Gabe and Henry outside, and I took the only course available, walking directly over to them as they came through the doors. "Hi, guys," I said. Gabe already knew Chad. I introduced him to Henry. When they exchanged greetings, I picked up a distinct coolness in Chad. He just wanted Henry to go away. "Henry," I said, "I didn't know you were interested in archaeology."
"Oh, yes, especially when Gabe has the floor."
He smiled at me, but spoke to Gabe and Chad. "You probably both know she's a Xenicon."
"No," said Chad. "What the hell's a Xenicon?"
Henry smiled.
"You just had dinner with one. They're people who've been trained how to respond during an encounter with aliens."
He turned in my direction.
"Chase, have you by any chance decided whether you're going to join us on the Harbinger? I don't want to rush you, but we're running out of time."
That was how the moment came. Make up your mind.
"No,"
I said. "I'm going to pass, Henry. Sorry, I just can't manage it, but thank you." Chad's eyes closed momentarily. He looked relieved, but I could see the disappointment in Gabe's expression. He'd expected more of me. Henry nodded.
"I understand, Chase."
Gabe checked the time.
"Got to get moving, guys. Chase, you need a ride home?"
"Chad's got me covered, Gabe. Thanks."
"Okay. See you tomorrow."
He headed into the parking lot. Henry watched him go and then told Chad he'd been glad to meet him.
"Chase," he added, "I'm sorry you can't make it. Take care."
Chapter 2. From Eleanor Zaraka, speaking at Salem University on Rimway, 1427. There's no question that the most significant scientific breakthrough in human history occurred 8,000 years ago, when Eugene Taimundo demonstrated that FTL travel was possible. It was an incredible step forward, in every way imaginable, but it came with a cost. We learned quickly that the universe was effectively empty. We've been looking for someone to talk with for thousands of years, and we all know how that's turned out. Alex told me that if he'd been in Henry's place, I'd have been his first choice to pilot the Harbinger, and he wouldn't have taken no for an answer. Chad, though, was clearly happy.
"I know you wanted to go, and I'm sorry it was such a difficult decision. I hope you didn't turn it down just for my sake, but I'll admit, I wasn't looking forward to having you out of my life for the next couple of months. Worse than that, aliens are unpredictable."
A few days after the archaeological conference, the Columbia finally arrived at Skydeck. The HV cameras were there, so we all got to watch in hologram format while its team of four emerged from the connecting tube onto the concourse. A crowd was waiting, and they wasted no time delivering enthusiastic applause. I had no trouble recognizing Robbie Joe. It had been a few years, but she hadn't changed at all. The Hawkman Network's Lester Wilkinson managed to corner Quaid McCann.
I know you weren't supposed to establish contact with them, but did you try?
No, he said.
We didn't.
Did you receive any radio signals?
There was nothing. As far as we could tell, they didn't even have a radio.
But they had lights?
Yes, they did.
It's also been reported that they had electricity. Is that correct?
Yes.
How could you tell? Did they have motors running somewhere?
The light in their windows was steady.
It was clearly not candles.
That sounds a bit speculative.
McCann looked annoyed.
We like to speculate, Lester, and they had lampposts that were steady, electric, not gas.
One of the other interviewers got to Vince Reddington, the backup pilot.
You guys actually were able to see the aliens in that town, am I right?
That is correct, yes.
It must have been disappointing that you couldn't go down and knock on a few doors, say hello to them.
It was.
Why didn't you just do it?
It's against the rules.
We're talking about something that happens twice in several thousand years. Why not bend the rules a bit?
Reddington looked toward McCann.
That's a question you have to ask the boss.
The next morning, I was back at my desk in the country house, tracking the authenticity of two artifacts that had been offered to us for auction. They were a link and a blaster whose owner maintained they'd once belonged to Christopher Sim, the legendary hero from the Mute War. Alex thought they were not authentic, which was probably true. There was no way to establish a connection with Sim. His initials were on the link. We knew that Sim's link had carried his initials, but nothing could prevent someone from taking care of that detail. There was no way to authenticate either object. I tried to track down what had happened to his blaster, but there was no record. The weapon matched one that Sim had used, but there was no way to connect it to him. I couldn't trace their sources, so the owner's claim could not be substantiated. He had gotten both artifacts from his great-grandfather, now deceased. The great-grandfather had served during the war, but there was no visible connection between him and Sim, or his celebrated ship, the Corsarius. Artifacts don't matter, unless you can establish their authenticity. I was just finishing the assignment, getting ready to send the results to Alex, when Jacob, our AI, informed me there was a story breaking on the Hawkman Network that I would probably find interesting. Mary Everson, one of the network anchors, blinked on. She was effectively seated behind a table in the middle of my office. Jacob had recorded it from the beginning.
Dipsar, she said, has announced that the follow-up mission to the Orion Nebula will be leaving in 8 days. As we've known for a while, they'll be using the Harbinger. Vince Reddington, who was one of the pilots on the Columbia, has joined the crew in the same role. They released the names several days ago of the other people who will be making the flight. And there's something else to add. I'm happy to report that the mission, which promises to be historic, will be covered in detail by the Hawkman Network. Our longtime news anchor, Lester Wilkinson, will be on board the Harbinger. He'll be doing daily reports, so we'll all be along on the flight.
Alex came down a few minutes later.
You okay?
He asked.
Of course.
Henry sent out messages to, I presume, everyone who'd expressed a desire to join the follow-up mission. He regretted not being able to accommodate everybody, but explained again his reluctance to put anyone unnecessarily at risk. If another opportunity arose, he hoped we would not hesitate to come forward again. Another opportunity? Hard to believe he delivered that line with a straight face. Robbie Joe called that evening. I'd just arrived home when she blinked on in my living room.
Hi, Chase.
She was wearing the smile that had lit up schoolrooms as beautiful as ever.
Good to see you again. I got your message. Thank you.
Hi, Robbie Joe. Good to see you, too. You're having a pretty nice career.
I guess we both are, Chase. You have a pretty nice job. It's not bad. I have to tell you, I'd have loved having you along on the flight. Most of it was pretty boring until we caught up with the aliens. It would have been nice, I said. Next time you do one of these things, keep me in mind. Absolutely. By the way, I've enjoyed your Alex Benedict books. Thank you. Thank you. We could have used you to provide some PR for us. Are you serious? You guys discovered real aliens. The PR's built in. I'm not so sure. They're aliens, but they live in a small village on the edge of nowhere. She was leaning back in an armchair. Not too much excitement there. It would have been different if Mac had let us go down and say hello. Anyhow, Chase, I've got to go. Maybe we can get together for lunch sometime? I'd like that. I'll give you a call. The week passed quickly. We never quite managed to get together. Robbie Jo was being interviewed by everyone in sight. She was a speaker at events all around the Confederacy, and she was a guest on every talk show. Her life had gotten crowded, and I'd simply have to wait my turn. Chad told me several times that he understood I was disappointed about not being on the follow-up mission, but that he was glad, as he put it, that I hadn't gone off into the wilderness. Hawkman ran shows every night, interviewing participants, talking with people from the Columbia, and going on about how much everyone was looking forward to finding out what the village was doing alone on the planet. McCann, appearing on Night Talk, reminded Henry Cassell and his team that the Spaulding Mandate was still in effect, that he would personally see that anyone who violated it would be prosecuted. And finally, the time of departure arrived. I suspect everybody who could make it boarded the shuttle at the Andaquar spaceport with Lester Wilkinson and the Hawkman team and rode up to Skydeck that morning. Departure would be the following day. We watched them check into the Harbinger. Wilkinson interviewed Sam Carmody and Chuck Dumas. I'd never been in the same area physically with either of them. Both are Xenicons, of course. Sam from Delaconda, Chuck from Earth. Vince Reddington said he was anxious to go back out to Corella, and this time, he hoped, we'd at least get to say hello. Two more Xenicons, both women, had not yet arrived. Autumn Ulbrich was from Seraglia, and Jennifer Hancock from Rambuckle. Wilkinson pushed through the crowd on the concourse and let himself into the Harbinger passenger cabin. Reddington and Henry Cassell were there, drinking coffee and watching a woman being interviewed on the HV. Wilkinson and his camera person arrived and took seats. They did a round of introductions, leaving the cameraman out. Henry told the Hawkman host how much they appreciated his coming along. I think, said Henry, you'll find this a unique experience. Wilkinson was in his later years, with a long history of bringing down corrupt politicians and anybody else who engaged in questionable activities. His most celebrated moment had come early in his career when he confronted Margot de Pierre, then president of the Confederacy, over using her position to control elections. It was an interview that led to her resignation a few weeks later. Wilkinson's name became a synonym for standing up to power. He told Hancock he was happy to meet her. If you're able to talk to one of the aliens, Jennifer, he continued, what's the first question you'll ask? She frowned. Apparently, she'd been expecting something else. Hancock looked as if she'd been around the block a few times. Her eyes were riveted, not on Wilkinson, but on me, as she considered her reply. And that was probably the surprise, discovering she'd just as soon get away from the cameras. I guess my first question would be, how are you doing? She was as tall as Wilkinson, with red hair cut short, and an expression that suggested she had better things to do than talk to the media. And what would be the second question? I guess it would be whether they are surprised to see us. The second part of the show came on a few hours later, live from the Starlight Hotel, where the Xenicon team was staying.
Autumn Ulbrich, had joined them. She was a late addition. Tori Hackelman from Fishbowl had pulled out during the last few days. Problem at home, she'd said. Autumn had been the replacement. Wilkinson asked Henry Cassell about McCann's warning that if they violated the Spaulding mandate, he would see to the prosecution.
I have great respect for Professor McCann, Henry said, but Dipsar supports what we're doing. We have been preparing for years for precisely this issue.
We got to watch them eat, got details on the menu, and listened to a conversation about how anxious everyone was to get started. The table was set beside a long window that provided a dazzling view of Rimway, which dominated the sky. The hotel management had to be happy. The following morning, the passengers and crew made their way through a crowded concourse to the entry tube and boarded the Harbinger. We were able to listen in on the exchanges between Skydeck Comm Ops and the ship. Wilkinson was on the bridge when they separated from the dock. He signed off as they made their exit through the bubble that surrounds the space station. When he came back 2 hours later, he was still seated beside Vince Reddington. The two of them were looking out through the wraparound. We could see the control board, and Reddington, and of course, the sky.
We're getting ready to make our jump into Armstrong space, Wilkinson said. Vince, we won't be losing contact, will we?
We'll be fine.
The pilot pointed toward Wilkinson's lap.
You'll want to buckle in.
Yes, yes, I forgot.
He took care of it and smiled at us. I assumed Wilkinson had prepared what he hoped would be intriguing questions and probably would have been for his viewers, like, how does it feel when you go into Armstrong space and all the lights in the sky go out? Or, what were your thoughts coming on board, knowing that you would be contained inside these bulkheads for a couple of months? The problem is that you can only ask each question once, and it's probably not something the viewers haven't heard before. This was the first HV series of its kind I'd ever heard of, and they were only a half hour into it when everything started to sound repetitive.
I suspect, Alex said, nobody will try this kind of coverage again.
On a flight with a one-way, four-week duration, they were all going to be sitting around reading, doing puzzles, playing computer games, and watching movies. And sleeping. None of that amounts to good entertainment when it's nonstop. To make things even worse, aside from the fact that there's nothing to see through the windows when you're traveling through Armstrong space, there's also an absolute sense of stillness that takes over. The vehicle does not seem to be moving. Riding an interstellar, somebody once said, is like sitting in a hotel under a dark, gloomy sky. The normal routine is to surface roughly once a week to give the passengers a break. They made their first exit after only 4 days. Whatever remorse I'd felt about staying behind was gone. Chuck Dumas was probably the oldest person on board. He'd been a high school teacher for a while, but eventually just decided to do physics research and play chess.
I miss the kids, he told Wilkinson. I'd like to go back and live those days again, but I just don't have the energy for that kind of thing anymore.
Says the guy, replied Wilkinson, who's sitting in an interstellar going out to Orion Nebula to say hello to aliens.
He interviewed Reddington twice during the first few days. Mostly he asked questions about the Columbia mission. How did he feel about having an opportunity to meet aliens on that flight and coming away with no contact?
Ask me, he said, after we get home from this one.
During the second week, there were reports that the audience had shrunk almost to nothing. People were going back to watching My Life with Sally and On the Edge and Party High. The Harbinger show, which had been playing for an hour each evening, slipped back to 30 minutes and then to occasional 15-minute break-ins during the late-night talk shows.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.